Open your books up, please, to page 33, Language of the Heart. This is an article written in 1946 by Bill and published in the Grapevine. It has a very interesting history. This article was written shortly after Bill had written the first draft of the traditions, which at that time were called 12 points of AA tradition. And we now know them as the long form of the traditions. A couple of three or four years later, when the traditions were formally adopted by the First International, they had been condensed to the so-called short form. So Bill is writing now at a time when, shortly after he had just completed putting the 12 traditions together. Remember that he had been asked to do this, and so he drew on all of the experience that had come before. He drew on many things. For example, the Washingtonian Society in the early 1800s, and the experience that many had had with respect to money and power and prestige. And also, I don't have any doubt in my own mind that he was spiritually guided in writing them. Because what came out of the 12 traditions essentially are 12 spiritual principles, which are the principles which guide our groups and our fellowship, just as surely as the 12 steps guide us as individuals. The traditions also have a very powerful and very strong applicability to us individually. Much of what the traditions espouse in terms of the way we live together as a group apply equally to the way we conduct ourselves. And so, we're not going to read the whole article, but I'd like to start on page 33, the last partial paragraph at the bottom of the page. So, continued our friends, within the Society of Alcoholics Anonymous, it appears to us that you have a democracy, a dictatorship, and an anarchy, all functioning at once. Do these sleep quietly in the same bed? These same concepts whose conflict is tearing apart our world today? Yet we know that AA works. So you people must have somehow become reconciled to these great forces. Tell us, if you can, what holds AA together? Why doesn't AA tear apart too? If each AA has personal liberty, which can amount to license, why doesn't your AA society blow up? It ought to, but it doesn't. Our friends of the world outside, so puzzled over this paradox, are apt to miss the most significant statement as they read our point one. It is this: AA must continue to live, or most of us will surely die. That stark assertion carries a world of meaning for every member of Alcoholics Anonymous. Now, if you've been wondering what the significance of the first tradition is, that in essence we have to put the unity of the fellowship ahead of ourselves, and that our personal recovery depends upon it. And how can that be? Well, here's the answer. While it is perfectly true that no AA group can possibly coerce an alcoholic to contribute money, to conform to the 12 steps of our recovery program, or to the 12 points of AA tradition, each member is nevertheless most powerfully compelled in the long run to do these very things. The truth is that in life of each AA member there lurks a tyrant. His name is alcohol. He's cunning and ruthless. His weapons are misery, insanity, and death. No matter how long we may stay sober, he always stands at each man's elbow, ever watchful of an opportunity to resume his destruction. Like an agent of the Gestapo, he ever threatens each AA citizen with torture or extinction. Unless, of course, the AA citizen is willing to live unselfishly, often placing the welfare of AA as a whole ahead of his own personal plans and ambitions. Apparently, no human being can force alcoholics to live happily and usefully together. But Mr. John Barleycorn can, and he often does. A story will illustrate. Some time ago, we made a long list of our seeming failures in the first years of AA. Every alcoholic on the list had been given a good exposure. Most of them had attended AA meetings for several months. After slipping and sliding around, they had all disappeared. Some said they were not alcoholic. Others couldn't stand for our belief in God. Many had developed intense resentments toward their fellows. Anarchists at heart, they could not conform to our society. And because our society did not conform to them, they quit. But only temporarily. Over the years, most of these so-called failures have returned, often becoming magnificent members. We never ran after them. They returned of their own accord. Each time I spot one newly back, I ask him why he has rejoined our fold. Invariably, his answer runs like this. When I first contacted AA, I learned that alcoholism is a disease, an obsession of the mind that compels us to drink, and a sensitivity of the body that condemns us to go mad or die if we keep on. I also learned that AA worked, at least for some alcoholics, but I then disliked AA methods, hated some of the alcoholics I met there, and still toyed with the idea that I could do the job of quitting all by myself. After several more years of terrible drinking, which I found I was powerless to control, I gave up. I returned to AA because it was the only place left to go. I tried everything else. Arrived at this point, I knew I must act quickly, that I must adopt the 12 steps of the AA recovery program, that I must cease hating my fellow alcoholics, that I must now take my place among them as a very small part of that great whole, the Society of Alcoholics Anonymous. It all boiled down to the simple question of do or die. I had to conform to AA principles or else. No more anarchy for me, so I'm back. Now, by the way, that or else is indicative of what the Big Book tells us. People like to say there are no musts in A, balderdash, there's a whole bunch of them. They're all over the place. One of the things we got to remember that must in AA means or else. Or else. This illustration shows why we of AA must hang together or else hang separately. We are players at a stern drama where death is the prompter of those who falter. Could anyone imagine a more powerful restraint upon us than this? And he goes on in the same vein. In more modern times, we say that alcoholism is a self-cleaning oven, and the traditions and the steps are the principles by which we must live our lives, collectively and individually. And failing that, we are in grave jeopardy. It's just that simple. And so, does this answer the question of why it is that the unity of our fellowship is determinative of our personal recovery? I think it does. But there is a fair question also. What about the person out in the hinterlands who has no group? This was asked just the other day, I think, by Howie, because he comes up with some interesting questions. But there's an answer, you know, and we find it in the Big Book, just as there is always an answer. It is this. The Big Book does not suggest that we are going to survive for long out there hanging and twisting slowly in the wind all by herself. What it says, and we have to get to chapter 11 to find it. Chapter 11 devotes a substantial part of its pages to a discussion and an urging of us who are single members out there forming our own group. And it shows us, by illustration, of how the original groups formed, how to go about doing that. In other words, it is urging that which they found to be necessary, the formation of a group. Now, there are a few glowing examples of people who did not do that. For example, this is a true story, the sheep herder in Australia, whose only contact with AA collectively was once a year when he brought his wool to market. But when he did bring his wool to market, he spent a lot of time meeting with other alcoholics. Came the year when there was going to be a major convention in his city, he sheared his sheep early, even though he was going to lose money doing it, so that he could get to the city and be part of that convention. So though he wasn't able to do it more than once a year, he stayed sober, and while he was available, he helped people. And that's all that God asks of us. Not that we do the impossible, but that when it is possible, that we follow his directions, that we do his will. That's enough for me. This is a time when we like to share with each other. And who would like to share their personal experience or their beliefs about all of this? Or if you have any questions, bring them up. We'll try to answer them. Who's going to be first?
I'm Tom, I'm an alcoholic, and we're reading this, and I'm like, I'm so dry. I've been dry for like years, you know, like, and I'm just like miserable in my head. And this is no more anarchy for me. I'm back. Well, I'd like to say that. I'd like to say it. I just can't get out of my shit. It's work. It's screwed up with my friend at work, or. Where I used to work, and just everybody, my girlfriend. I don't know. I listen to these CDs, and like I play God, and I'm, you know, like changing around, and I hear them over and over and over and over and over and over. Repetition, you know, and it's like I'm getting sick of this shit. It's not that bad. I really enjoy doing it. I mean, I can do it the rest of my life. But I just can't seem to get out of my, I don't know. I messed around, and I went off. Everybody's so prejudiced, that's why, you know. I went off my meds about a year and a half ago, and I was off, you know. I've been sober 13 years, and I thought, well, I think I'm cured now, and I'll just go off my meds. I'll keep going to AA meetings, you know. So I went off, and then that just took me, I'm still on that ride. I can't get back, I'm back on it, and it's not doing the same job it was before, and I'm having a hard time working the steps, and I'm just like hanging on right now. This meeting, the stairway group and the meetings Jim does is like keeping me not drinking. And I don't know. I've never cried in sobriety. I never even cried. I think last time I cried, I was like six. I did watch 101 Dalmatians. I think I was just tired. I don't know. I get really bad headaches. But I know that God works, and I'm living away. Thanks.
Yeah, thanks, Tom, for sharing that.
It's amazing how everything ties together.
Oh, yeah.
What jumped out at me was I also learned that AA worked, at least for some alcoholics.
Uh-huh.
And right when you were reading that, that jumped off the page at me. That was really the only thing. I was like, and I just started thinking, and then it all went back, and it's really not, the people say if you want it enough or this or that, but it really comes down to work, you know. God's going to do what he promises, but you have to do the work. and that's the whole key,
right?
Right there, that's everything wrapped up. So that's about it. That's all I have.
Oh, good. Do you remember what Dr. Bob said about that?
Yeah. No, I don't.
All right, Tom. Where's your big book? You got it right? Oh, never mind. I got mine. All right, here we go.
Well,
we're not going to worry about him. We're going to think. We're going to look and see what Dr. Bob had to say about this, because he makes it real clear. If you have your big book, it's on page 181. If you think you are an atheist, an agnostic, a skeptic, or have any other form of intellectual pride which keeps you from accepting what is in this book, I feel sorry for you. If you still think you're strong enough to beat the game alone, that's your affair. But if you really and truly want to quit drinking liquor for good and all, and sincerely feel that you must have some help, we know that we have an answer for you. It never fails. If you go about it with one half the zeal you've been in the habit of showing when you were getting another drink, your Heavenly Father will never let you down. Chapter 5 says, rarely have we seen a person fail. Dr. Bob says never. It never fails. If we go, and just what you were pointing out, it all depends upon us. If it's to be, it's up to me. It's a question of whether I'm willing to do the work or not. And if I am, what Dr. Bob says here is true. It never fails. So when we read that statement, in as you just did, in the language of the heart, we have to understand it in that light, that there are those alcoholics for whom this does not work because they're not willing to do the work to get it. It's not automatic to just come in here, go to meetings and not drink. That doesn't have anything to do with it. It's working the steps is the only thing that works. Everything else is a chimera. It's a bus going down a blind alley to a dead end. The only recovery program we have in AA is 12 steps. We don't have anything else. And what do you say to somebody who can't not drink because they are powerless over alcohol? Oh, by the way, just don't drink and go to meetings. That's a joke, isn't it? You tell somebody you're powerless, you can't stop, but by the way, stop. Total balderdash.
You know, alcohol and addiction is such an amazing thing on how it works in our mind. You know, I truly believe it's, you know, I definitely want to be a spiritual person. I believe in God, and I truly believe that Satan has a main play in what our mind, what our weakness is, and how he tries in every way possible, as kind of as possible, to play with us to get what he wants out of us. And I'm just amazed that, you know, it doesn't matter. I've been in and out of rooms and done a lot of studying and trying to figure things out, and it's all figured out in the big book.
Sure, right.
But it's amazing how an alcoholic mind wants to try to figure out how to do it an easier, softer way.
Sure.
You know, I mean, it amazes me, because I tried about everything to, you know, oh, well, there's got to be something else to make it better. You know, it's always wanting to be a perfectionist about things. And I had to learn that, like, hey, nothing doesn't have to be perfect. Let it go, let it go. But and it is a lot of work, and it's a lot of soul searching. And I know for me, there's no way I'll be able to stay sober if I don't, you know, get rid of my past, my garbage, and my character defects, And if I don't live a spiritual way of life, which is, you know, making my amends to other people and not harming anybody, you know, treating people in a loving, caring way, and as soon as I make a mistake, I have to admit it right away and go to that person and ask for forgiveness, or, you know, they don't have to forgive me, but I've got to go and do my part. Because anytime I do something that hurts other people, it bothers me so bad inside that it won't stop playing in my head, you know, until I make amends. And that's just like one little thing where somebody got upset at me, it'll play in my head until I make amends. And so that's just the new stuff coming up. So if my garbage isn't totally gone from the past, I'll stand a chance to stand sober. So, and I truly appreciate being here because you have a very clear message. And so many people at so many meetings tell you so much garbage. I would hate to be a newcomer and not know where to go for a good meeting.
Yeah.
And I can truly understand why so many people don't make it, because they have no clue or what to do. Now, I go to one meeting, it's a beginner's meeting, and there's tons of recovery in that room, and everybody in there argues about how it works. I mean, I'm amazed. I don't need to be a beginner to do that.
Okay.
But you know when somebody's doing it right.
Well, there's a very simple way to handle it. If somebody tells you something you're supposed to do, that they tell you got to do this, is this the way to do it? You ask them, gee, where is that in the big book?
Yeah.
You know what the other question is? Where is God in that equation? Because that will rule out all the human solutions.
You know, well, one thing for me is, God's removed my urge to drink, and he's removed my urge to do illegal drugs, and I have back pain, and I still, when I'm in pain, I still want to take medication. Medication I take is kind of designed for addicts. But I don't even want that, you know. I want to get past that pivot point where I don't have anything in me, period. Because I want to make sure every decision I make, that my mind is clear enough that I don't make any bad choices, or if I do, I need to rectify it.
Right, that's good. You know, you've described a dirty trick that your brain plays on you. You know, that dirty trick is urging you to set up a standard of perfection. Because when you do that, all you're doing is setting yourself up for failure. And that's the way your brain gets you. See, you failed again. So we claim progress, we don't claim perfection. We do the very best we can to follow the principles of the program, to do the next right thing when it presents itself, and not to hurt another person. Leave the results up to God. We do that and we're going to be okay. There's the beautiful out clause in the big book is that as long as you do what you believe God would have you do, and humbly leave the results up to him, you'll be just fine. So this business of perfection and striving for perfection is a trap for the unwary. That's a spring gun, man. You walk into that, blah, it's going to blow your head off. Because it's going to lead inevitably to failure. We are not perfect, and we can never be perfect. And there was one of the most startlingly stupid statements of all time that Bill Wilson made in the 12 and 12, that the only step we can work perfectly is the first step. Utter nonsense. I don't know where the hell that came from. Just completely off the wall. But there isn't perfection here, and there isn't intended to be. We work toward perfection, but we don't demand it of ourselves. Big difference, right? If you're doing that, you got to watch it, because that's a big trap. You're setting yourself up for failure, for sure.
Today, when we were reading page 130, we just came across a section where I guess I've heard before that there's certain places that you find yourself in the big book, and I identified in many different places, but just reading that line today, you know, just hit me as 100% me. And it just says, we think dad will be on a firmer foundation than the man who's placing, the man being me, Tom, who's placing business or professional success ahead of spiritual development. I had 5 years clean, and I guess it's about 12 years ago when I went out, and toward the end of my sobriety, and most of that were in other programs, not in AA. So I never read the big book, and they didn't have any of this thing. You know, but I placed it, the most important, the only way I knew, and you talk about being brought up, and all the things you're brought up with, to be successful, to have your education, you know, to be financially successful, that became the most important thing in my life. And here, I got married in the program, I had children, and that's what became so important. And there I was working till, you know, 11 or later at night, a few nights a week, rarely around my family, and, you know, definitely doesn't work. I mean, I just was so miserable. And then eventually I stopped going to meetings, and 2 years later moved down here. You know, I thought it was New York. That's why I was miserable. And then, you know, even more interesting is, like, you know, when we read how it works every day, you know, you just look at little things, you know, the importance of that page 58, because that's the year I was born. But when I was born, they didn't tell me anything about that, even though I needed it. I think I needed it from very early on. I've since I've been clean this time, there's just, I pray a lot, and I really see God guiding me in my life sometimes, and this week I've had an ongoing thing going on with my sponsor over, you know, what I need, what actions he suggested I should take. And he was saying, you know, Tom, you have to look, you can't look at things clearly. And I know I can't trust my judgment many times, because for the last 12 years, my judgment has been, you know, without God in my life, and with alcohol and drugs and you know, vanity and just all the wrong things driving my decisions. And some things just became, I had to take some actions this week. Yeah, I've been married 16 years, and my wife left a hospital against medical advice that she was court ordered into, and I had gone up there for a meeting, and I still wasn't sure what to do. My sponsor said, you know, you need to keep her away from your kids and out of the house. And last time I didn't listen to my sponsor, I didn't listen to the doctor, psychologist, I didn't listen to anyone. She was back in my house, and I was clean maybe a month. And the next thing I knew is, you know, I wasn't spiritually fit, and I'm still not spiritually fit. You know, I'm working toward that goal, and to me, that's the most important thing in my life today, and that's really the big difference for me. But what I was able to do, and when I ask God for, I pray about this all the time, and I don't hear the answers. You know, I mean, not in my head. I just don't. And when I sit and try to meditate, except for that meeting sometimes on Sunday night, I don't feel anything. I sit there and I think, well, you know, why isn't anything happening here? You know, why can't I get some clarity? But, you know, right now I get it through other people. And what happened is, I went to this meeting 2 days ago, or 3 days ago, whenever it was. I guess it was on Wednesday. And I wasn't sure where. I actually went up with a car to pick up my wife and have this meeting with the counselors, and I was going to take her home. And I sat down with these people, and they said, you know, you cannot bring her into your house. And three different people told me the same thing. And then my wife was supposed to come into the meeting, and while this whole meeting was on, she split. She had someone pick her up and left. And you know, it finally, you know, finally hit me. And I know that that's the type of way that God guides me, because I don't want to see things. I don't want to see things a lot of time. And dealing with someone that's in active addiction, you know, all the insanity that we're talking about, and you know, today, I mean, she's missing a few days, and today I get a call, and it's like, you know, all I could say to her was that you know, today I don't want to die anymore. You know, I don't have great days every day. I have good days. I have days that aren't so great. But when I was using, I mean, this is just a few months ago for me, all I wanted every day, every time I was crashing, all I wanted to do is die. I mean, that's, I couldn't live, I knew I couldn't live like that anymore. And I had that moment of clarity where I knew it had to stop. And it may have taken me 6 white shifts after that to finally stop, but I never, I kept on coming to meetings and kept on trying until I was able to get strong enough. So I deal like with that insanity on a day, not a daily basis now, but it's always in my mind. You know, someone that you really love and care about who you knew sober, and you've seen sober, and you've seen someone change and grow spiritually, and all of a sudden you see the other side of it, you know, which is exactly where I was a few months ago. Just being in total despair and insanity and feeling like the entire world is caving in on you, you know, on a daily basis. And I just really thank God that I'm able to, he gave me another chance, and he gave my children a chance now. Thanks.
You must not, however, give up on the idea that you'll be able to live your life based upon inspiration, because you will. You might, tonight when you get home, read the bottom of 86 and the top of 87. And that'll tell you what's coming. And it tells you that eventually you will rely upon the inspiration you receive from God. You'll be able to trust your instincts. And you won't have to try to have a committee decide for you what you ought to be doing. And they don't know. They can guess, but they don't know. Only you can know for sure, and only you can know with God's help. And that's what you got to be aiming for, man, to be able to live your life based upon inspiration. You will come to rely upon it if you do that. Okay?
One of the things that for me is, you know, if I have pretty good faith, then my life is much more serene. And God helps me, like, through other people, for sure. I figure every person I come in contact, they have a gift for me, and I have one for them, so I try to figure out what it is. And then, I mean, I will see something on a TV show, and there'll be a piece of the narrative that just hits me. It's like, wow. You know, or I'll see a billboard, or I'll hear a song. I mean, it's amazing all the different places that things start coming from that click, but the message God tries to get through to me. I always wonder if other people just hear it, you know, directly hear it, but, you know, but for me, it works around the place.
Well, the Big Book says that we will develop that vital sixth sense. And that means precisely that we do have the ability to be intuitively instructed by God, to be inspired. We may not be inspired at all times, but there will be the times of inspiration and intuitive understanding. And these are the things that we foster and nurture with prayer and meditation and working with others. That's a big part of spiritual growth. That's what the 11th step tells us. Seek through prayer and meditation to improve our conscious contact with God. And that improving that conscious contact means exactly that more and more we get to live our lives based on inspiration rather than upon self or upon the sometimes shaky advice of others.
I know for me, my gut feeling's always right. You know,
well, that's
if
good.
If I ever go against my gut feeling, I'm screwed. I know.
Well, you call it gut feeling, and I call it instinct, but I found my experience that most people's instincts are good. It's just that we don't trust them. And we make decisions based on self rather than decisions based upon what we know to be the right thing to do. Who's next now?
Yeah, my name's Howard, and I'm a member of AA. You know, there's a real interesting analogy with this bottom paragraph on 34 and going on to 35. Instead of putting just AA in there, I'm thinking of, you can also put in there the analogy, say, to a Marine group or anybody who's going to war. And I'm running in my mind, I happen to be a war buff and a little bit of a war historian, and think of all those landing craft on Normandy, and you're getting off those craft, and your guys are getting picked off one and two, and you're out there by yourself, you're scared to death, and then, as was told so well by Stephen Ambrose, that the way that we actually got over there, and we actually started to get a foothold, was one and two guys matching up and getting to the top of a bluff, and one and two here, and one and two here, and all of a sudden they get to the top of the bluff, and there's five of them, and they're looking for their other buddies, and they're all of a sudden they're at the top, there's seven or eight in a group over here. Individual heroism with the groups getting together, and that's how they got over the bluffs. They weren't in groups. You know, there was chaos on the beach. But if you just take a look at what was happening here, and some of them wanted to go off on their side and just run. They were so scared. They may not have liked what was going on with the different way that they were taught to do things. But everybody's, or most of the guys, started to team up. And that's how we started to make a little bit of progress. And once we got behind the machine guns that were on the bluff, all of a sudden we started to make some distance. And then they got started to find out that by sticking together as a group, they were much more powerful than if they were there alone. And then by fear enough, they started to continue to stay in their groups. And that's how they started to move. And it all, and then come right to the top of the page. I returned to AA, or my group, my group of 5, 7, 9 guys, because it was the only place left to go. I tried everything else, say running out on your own. I arrived at this point, I knew I must act quickly. I must adopt the 12 steps or the methods of the group program, that I must cease running on my own, and I must now take my place among the group as a very small part of the great whole. The whole part being, let's say, in this, the whole Marine Division, the society of the Marine Division. It all boiled down to a simple question: do or die. And certainly you can see that in that analogy, fighting a war, what we're all doing here, it's apropos. I had to conform to an AA principle or else I would die. No more anarchy for me, so I'm back. I just think that that's an interesting analogy, because it exactly is what we're doing in here, that the sum of the whole is much stronger than any one of the individual people there, and actually fear in and of itself is what makes the unity of the whole, of the group, so much more important than any one of us. So that's why AA as a whole has to survive more so than any one of us as an individual, because in essence that's what we all will come back to. That's why we're all here, because the group has survived, and so it's been here for us to survive. It will be here for many others to survive into the future. That's all for me.
Thank you, Doc.
The only problem with that, Howie, is fear kept them alive. Fear kills us.
Well, fear got them together.
And they kept each other.
Which probably works about the same with us, but after that, it isn't going to keep us sober any more than they were going to stay alive with fear. I went through 7 human wave attacks, and I know the fear was there, but ultimately the fear was no longer a dominant factor. You either were working as fire teams or you were going to get killed. And we worked together. You go past the fear after a while. So fear is the maybe the factor that gets everybody together, but it cannot be that which keeps us sober. It will not keep us sober.
And it's the training and the principles, right?
Sure, of course. Anybody else like to share? Marilyn.
I'll be real quick. My name is Marilyn. I'm an alcoholic. I too had 14 years and went out, and so I could really relate to the words of the, it's like hanging right next to you waiting to get you. And also I could relate to how it said that that hated some of the alcoholics I met there. I remember when I was out for the 4.5 years, people, and I met people that were in AA, would talk about AA or something like that. I'd go, oh, those AAs, I was in for 14 years, they're a bunch of hypocrites, and who wants to be like them, and they're all brainwashed, and they were like my enemies when I was out there thinking about AA people. And then when God told me to get sober again, and I said, but I don't like these AA people, and he said, it's not about you liking them, but I have a job for you to do, and that's to do the 12 steps, to do the 12-step work, as a matter of fact. He told me that I had to get a part of this program so that I could help other people. So I like how it says that I must cease hating my fellow alcoholics. I knew that I'd have to become a part of you again in order to help others. He told me I would have a purpose again in life instead of just flailing around. I was going to actually have a purpose. So I could really relate to this story. And it says, I must adopt the 12 steps of the AA program. Before, I remember for the 14 years, I barely had a mark in my big book. I barely looked my big book. I was sober on the fellowship. And so then when you let me down as people, you weren't perfect. I acted like, well, since you're not perfect, I don't have to be with you. But it's not about you. It's about the steps and the steps getting closer to God, not about people. So now I truly understand what it means about, what they mean about principles over personalities. Because I have to do the steps for me to stay sober. And I have to do self-analysis. I have to do that, not self-analysis, inventory. I have to look at my own self instead of your defects. I have to look at my defects and yours and quit hating you. So the thing that was keeping me out is the thing that keeps me in now is the fact that I'm supposed to help people, I'm supposed to look for the good in people and help people, not look for the bad and have that as a rationalization why I shouldn't be a part of you. It's not about whether I like you or not. It's about life or death. And I have to help in order to stay sober. So it's or else I die. So I gotta like you, whether I like you or not.
Okay, thank you, Meryl. All right, guys, let's close the meeting. Let this circle represent the unity of our fellowship. A moment of silence for those who are still suffering. And then we'll say the Lord's Prayer together. We don't say anything after we say amen. Thank you. Lord's Prayer.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power,